This conference will now be recorded.
In the last class, we discussed about Hodgkin's lymphoma and its various subtypes and its treatment and everything. Today, we're going to discuss about non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, NHL, the remainder of the lymphoma spectrum. So NHL is more common than Hodgkin's lymphoma because it contains more subtypes. So overall, NHL is more common than Hodgkin's lymphoma and has worse prognosis than Hodgkin's lymphoma. So epidemiology and incidence is increasing. NHL is greater than HD, Hodgkin's disease. Median age of presentation is 65 to 70 years. So this is a disease of the elderly, obviously because it's a lymphoma. The males are greater than females. More males are affected. This male predominance. More often clinically disseminated at diagnosis. So at diagnosis is not usually at the initial stage 1 or stage 2, it's usually at stage 3 or stage 4. So it's clinically disseminated at diagnosis. So B cell is 70% and T cell is 30%. B cell lymphomas of NHL are more common. So this is non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Indolent means they are very slow growing. Aggressive means they are very fast growing. Highly aggressive, that means they are fatal almost always at presentation. In Hodgkin's, we discussed in the last class. There's a classical Hodgkin's, which contains all four types. And then there's a nodular predominant, lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin's, which is containing 5%. This contains 95%. Multiple myeloma is a tumor of the plasma cells. Here under B cell, you have follicular, SLL, CLL, marginal zone, and LP. Then Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. This is a T or NK cell. Then mycosis fungoides, Sézary syndrome, primary cut ALCL. And aggressive ones, there's DLBCL. We'll discuss this in the next few slides. Mantle cell, primary fusion, angioimmunoblastic, etc. And then highly aggressive, we have B cell, pre-B cell, lymphoblastic, Burkitt's, and then pre-lymphoblastic in case of this one. So the real classification is the revised European American classification using immunophenotype, cytogenetics, molecular diagnostics. They reclassify lymphomas by diagnostic criteria and not by risk categories. So this is probably because of risk categories, right? Indolence, aggressive, and highly aggressive. But the classification that we have discussed in the last class is this one. The next slide. The frequency of NHL subtypes in adults, we already discussed this previously. Here, the most common one is indolent. All the indolent types are more common. Then followed by diffuse large B cell, which is again aggressive. And then mantle cell, peripheral T cell, other subtypes with the frequency less than 2% is all 9%, and composite lymphoma means mixed lymphomas. So this is the WHO real classification of lymphoma neoplasm. This is in the last class. This B cell neoplasm, T or NK cell neoplasm, and mask. So among these, there are a few important ones. We'll discuss them briefly in the next few slides. You don't need to remember each and every detail about them. You just need to know which of them are indolent, which of them are aggressive, which of them are very aggressive. And you need to know what are the treatment options for them. So first one is, according to behavior, indolent. These lymphomas grow slowly. The majority of NHLs are considered indolent. The majority, luckily for us. Indolent lymphomas are generally considered incurable with chemotherapy and or radiation therapy. So they need not require chemotherapy or radiation therapy because they're indolent, but they're usually incurable. That means they do not respond to chemotherapy or radiation. The next one is aggressive. These lymphomas have a rapid growth pattern. So the second most common form of NHL are curable with chemotherapy. So provided you diagnose them early, when they are in the rapid growth phase, then you can cure them with chemotherapy. But there might be a remission in them. Then very aggressive. These lymphomas grow very rapidly. They count for a very small proportion of NHL and can be treated with chemotherapy. Unless treated rapidly, these lymphomas can be life-threatening. So the identification is the main issue here. If you identify the lymphoma, you can go for chemotherapy, you can treat it. If you do not identify, it's life-threatening. NHL staging, we discussed this in the last class, the same as before, same as for Hodgkin's. Stage 1 is involvement of a single lymph node region or an extra lymphatic site. Stage 2 is involvement of two or more lymph node regions on the same side of the diaphragm or an extra lymphatic site or one or more lymph node on the same side of the diaphragm. So, do not cross the diaphragm on one side. If you have two lymph nodes or one lymph node plus one extra lymphatic site, then you will have stage 2. And if it's stage 1A or 2A or 1B and 2B is based on B symptoms. There's fever greater than 38 degrees for 3 consecutive days, drenching night sweats or unexplained loss of weight preceding 6 months, that comes under B symptoms. So 2B and 1B. Next one is 3A and 3B. Involvement of lymph node regions on both sides of the diaphragm. So involves on both sides, which may be accompanied by the spleen or by localized involvement of an extra lymphatic organ or site or both. So if there's a lymph node enlargement on one side of the diaphragm, so there's a, suppose there's a mediastinal involvement, then there can also be para-aortic or abdominal lymph node enlargement, or can be spleen enlargement. The fourth one is diffuse or disseminated involvement of one or more extra lymphatic organs with or without associated lymph node involvement. So this is metastasis. It disseminates everywhere through the lymphatic channels. Again, this is also discussed in the last class. This is stage 1, just from single group of lymph nodes. Stage 2, the group of lymph nodes above the diaphragm or one side of the diaphragm. Stage 3 on either side of the diaphragm. Stage 4 is disseminated to even the bone marrow. So non-Hodgkin lymphoma, specific subtypes, we will discuss them briefly now. So first one is follicular lymphoma. It's a low-grade lymphoma. It's indolent in growth. There's grade 1 small cell, grade 2 mixed cell, grade 3 large cell. It's chemotherapy sensitive, but it's incurable, right? Follicular lymphoma is indolent in growth. It's chemotherapy sensitive, but it's also incurable because the response to chemotherapy is not as good. But it's a slow-growing lymphoma. The next one is cutaneous T cell, or it's called mycosis fungoides. T cell lymphoma. This is a T cell. So low-grade indolent lymphoma again. Radiation therapy is sensitive here. Portal skin electron beam therapy is done. It controls disease for years. This peripheralization of lymphoma cells called Sézary cell. So it's also called Sézary syndrome. The other name for cutaneous T cell or mycosis fungoides is Sézary syndrome. There's a peripheralization of lymphoma cells that happens in the later part of the disease. Right? So this one is follicular lymphoma. This one is cutaneous T cell. Both are indolent lymphomas or low-grade lymphomas. Follicular lymphoma is chemotherapy sensitive. Cutaneous T cell or mycosis fungoides is radiation therapy sensitive. And then there's diffuse large cell, which is very aggressive. It's curable if chemosensitive upfront, but not so if chemo refractory or relapses within 6 months. So if you give chemotherapy, there's an early response to chemotherapy in the form of complete remission. That means it's curable. If not, it's chemo refractory. If there's a relapse within 6 months, that means it's very aggressive and eventually will cause fatality. It's the most common of all lymphomas and accounts for 35% of all the lymphomas. 31%, sir. 31% of all the lymphomas. So diffuse large B cell lymphoma, this is diffuse large B cell, is the most common type of lymphoma. It's very aggressive and is curable if chemotherapy is sensitive upfront. This is one important one, mantle cell lymphoma. It's an aggressive one, accounts for 6% of all the lymphomas. It's incurable with standard dose therapy. So stem cell transplant is offered often as a frontline consolidation treatment in younger patients. So in older patients, the benefits of doing stem cell transplant and the morbidity associated with using the drugs for a long period of time is considered to be a negative thing for stem cell transplant in younger patients where they have a larger lifespan to live after this. This is a morphology. There's a nodular pattern like this. There's a diffuse pattern. There's a classic mantle cell pattern, and there's a blastoid variant. So this classic mantle cell pattern is more common. It's a mantle type cell. That's why it's called classic mantle cell. So the next one is marginal zone. It's an indolent one again. Accounts for about 10% of all the lymphomas. There's a subcategory because of mild. It's a H. pylori induced lymphoma. There's a nodal. And there's an extranodal and a splenic subcategory. So here you can see a lymphatic nodule, the splenic bulb, and there you see the trabecular here. It's usually seen in the marginal zones of, that is why it's called marginal zone lymphoma. So the subcategories are mild, which is because of H. pylori, there's nodal, extranodal, and splenic. So that's about marginal zone. Then you have splenic lymphoma. You can see some lymphocytes here. It's same subcategory here, marginal zone, splenic lymphoma. This is the histopathological picture. Then primary CNS lymphoma, this is one important one. It's aggressive with poor outcome. It accounts for 1 to 2% of all lymphomas. And there's different chemotherapy treatments and often requires radiation to the brain. The brain dysfunction in younger patients, dementia in older patients. So this is the sequelae of this one. It's aggressive with poor outcome. Primary CNS lymphoma. Then you have anaplastic large cell lymphoma. It's an aggressive one, accounts for 2% of all the lymphomas. ALCL, ALK1 plus has better prognosis more. This is a gene defect that's seen. Anaplastic large cell lymphoma, ALK1 plus has better prognosis, more common in younger patients and children. ALK1 negative, as bad as any other T cell lymphoma. So it's an aggressive one. The treatment results of aggressive advanced NODs, non-Hodgkin lymphomas using different chemotherapy programs. Now, you know about CHOP regimen, we use this in Hodgkin lymphoma also, first generation. The complete remission is 50 to 55%, long-term survival is 35 to 50%. Whereas with second generation and third generation, the complete remission is more and even the long-term survival is much more. So MECOP-B is, along with neomycin, has the most chances of long-term survival. What is CHOP regimen? Every 3 weeks, at least 6 cycles, cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, hydrochloride, vincristine or oncovin, and then prednisolone. So this is CHOP regimen, cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, vincristine, and prednisolone. Every 3 weeks for at least 6 times. So what about CHOP versus R-CHOP for the first line therapy of follicular lymphoma concludes? So R-CHOP is rituximab added. R-CHOP results in a significant prolongation of the time to treatment failure and the progression-free survival. So the risk reduction for relapse is 35% itself. R-CHOP increases the overall response rate significantly. So may have a long-lasting beneficial effect. So may become the standard in the treatment of follicular lymphoma. So adding rituximab along with these drugs will be very useful for the treatment of lymphoma. So that is the important part. So here you have non-Hodgkin lymphoma, peripheral T-cell lymphoma. It's an aggressive one, the T-cell one accounts for 7% of all the lymphomas. Very poor prognosis, often associated with extranodal presentation, often requiring salvage treatment and transplant. So an aggressive one has very poor prognosis, peripheral T-cell lymphoma. The most important one of non-Hodgkin lymphoma is Burkitt's lymphoma. It's the most common one that is asked for you in exams is also this. It's very aggressive. It's curable with standard dose therapy, but requires very extensive chemotherapy protocol. There's a translocation of T8 to 14. This is the important translocation that's seen in Burkitt's lymphoma. Specific hematological finding is a steric appearance. Steric appearance is this one, Burkitt's lymphoma, steric night appearance. You can see the cells here. Like that's why it's called steric night appearance or steric sky appearance. So Burkitt's lymphoma is the most important, very aggressive. Translocation T8 to 14. Steric sky appearance in lymphoma. So lymphoblastic NHL is very aggressive. The treatment is with acute lymphocytic leukemia regimen, so ALL regimen is used. Often requires high dose therapy and allogeneic transplantation to relapse the refractory disease in case of younger patients. Next one is gamma delta T cell NHL is very, very aggressive, very poor outcome with standard dose therapy. High dose therapy and allogeneic transplantation is standard of care in the first remission. CD57 protein positive tumors, so aggressive and very poor outcome. So double hit lymphomas are when there are multiple gene expressions, MYC gene or translocation 14 to 18. Triple hit is in MYC gene, translocation 14 to 18 and BCL6 gene. So these are double hit lymphomas. There is multiple gene expressions in triple hit. So the aggressive therapy regimens are dose dense CHOP, CHOP with and hyper-CVAN. You don't need to know about aggressive. Bone marrow transplant for non-Hodgkin lymphoma indications are: one is refractory disease, second relapse, third is high risk in complete lymphoblastic and gamma delta cell lymphomas. Lymphoblastic, Burkitt's, and gamma delta T cell lymphomas. So this one, gamma delta T cell, lymphoblastic, and Burkitt's. These are the three ones which are very, very aggressive. So they require bone marrow transplantation. So I'll just go back to all the ones again, just to give you briefly. Follicular lymphoma is a low-grade lymphoma. It's indolent in growth. It's chemotherapy sensitive. Cutaneous T-cell or mycosis fungoides is low-grade or indolent. It's radiation therapy sensitive. Diffuse large B-cell lymphoma is the most common of all lymphomas. It's very aggressive. It's chemotherapy sensitive upfront. Then mantle cell is aggressive. It is curable, incurable with standard dose therapy. And then stem cell transplant is only offered in younger patients. Marginal zone is indolent, accounts for 10% of all lymphomas. There are subcategories of MALT, nodal, extranodal, and spleen. MALT is common in H. pylori disease. Then there's primary CNS lymphoma. It's aggressive with poor outcome. And then it requires radiation to the brain. And different chemotherapy treatments are also useful in CNS lymphoma. Then you have anaplastic large cell lymphoma, which is aggressive. And it accounts for 2% of all lymphomas. And it has better prognosis with ALK1 plus and then negative with ALK, it's bad prognosis as the other ones. This is a CHOP regimen, cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, hydrochloride, vincristine, and prednisolone. R-CHOP is adding rituximab along with CHOP regimen. Peripheral T-cell lymphoma is aggressive. It is very poor prognosis and usually requires salvage treatment and transplantation. Burkitt's lymphoma, very aggressive, poor prognosis again. Chemotherapy is extensive, translocation 8 to 14, steriskinet appearance is seen. Then you have lymphoblastic NHL treatment. It's very aggressive. It requires acute lymphoblastic leukemia treatment. It requires bone marrow transplant. So Burkitt's, lymphoblastic NHL, and gamma delta T cell will require allogenic stem cell transplantation. Very aggressive and very poor outcome. So indications and the role of rituximab. Rituximab binds to CD20 positive malignant and normal B cells, and then will cause cell lysis through three key mechanisms. So it's useful in both Hodgkin's lymphoma and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma also. Now the prognosis is low grade. The median survival of 10 years is seen in low grade lymphoma. In high grade, because of increasing age, advanced age, concomitant disease or raised LDH, T cell phenotype, they confer poor prognosis with a median survival of less than 1 year. So the most important thing to remember about non-Hodgkin lymphoma is that it's more common than Hodgkin lymphoma. Its incidence is increasing now. It has both chemotherapy and radiotherapy sensitive diseases. The classical subtypes that are seen in B cell and T cell ones. And B cell and T cell, they are both indolent, aggressive, and very aggressive. These are the classifications previously done. Now, you need to know a little bit about follicular lymphoma, a little bit about mantle cell lymphoma, a little bit about Burkitt's lymphoma, a little bit about anaplastic T cell lymphoma, and then about the ones that require bone marrow transplantation. So these are the ones that, about NHL in brief. You need to know what is the treatment regimen is most commonly used. CHOP regimen is used. Cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, vincristine, and prednisolone. It's usually given every 3 weeks for 6 cycles. And rituximab is added to it. It's called R-CHOP regimen. Now there are second line and third line therapies for NHL also. And the third line therapies have much higher chances of survival, but the adverse effects are also equally same. So that is why R-CHOP regimen is the most commonly used regimen right now in NHL. Whereas coming to prognosis, low grade has median survival of 10 years and high grade has increasing age, advanced age, concomitant disease, raised LDH, and T cell phenotype have poor prognosis. The other ones have a better prognosis. So when it is high grade, it's chances of survival of less than 1 year. So that is why NHL is a disease that you need to treat promptly after diagnosis. So that's the end of today's class. If you have any doubts, you can ask me.